Right, any questions? Okay, so let's begin. So yesterday we started discussing the notion of a geodesic. So let me remind you again what exactly we mean by geodesic. So let's consider two points on a manifold P and Q and consider any curve that connects P and Q. Now, if we are working in a flat Euclidean space, then we will call this curve a straight line if this was the shortest path between P and Q. In a general curve space, we will call this curve a geodesic if this is the extremal path between P and Q. Okay, it's not necessarily the shortest path, although for all many practical purposes you can even take it to be the shortest path. But we will think of this as a geodesic if it's the extremal path between P and Q. Now, what does that mean? Okay, what it means is the following. Okay, that let's imagine that we have this curve. Given this, let's consider another curve which is close to it, okay, which is also going from P to Q, but which is close to it. And let's suppose that the length of this curve is L and the length of this curve is L plus delta L. And then we'll call this curve a geodesic if delta L is 0 to first order. This is what we mean by extremal curve, and I'll explain what we mean by first order. Okay, but roughly this is the idea that a small variation, okay, should not change the length. Okay, that's what happens for a function. They are a minimum or a maximum. Okay, or more generally, they are an extreme. But we'll try to make this more precise. So to make this decide, we have to first decide how we want to label this curve. Okay, given a curve, okay, we have to have some mathematical way of describing that curve. Now we can think of various ways. In a straight line, normally when you draw a straight line, you can describe it by saying how different coordinates are all functions of one single coordinate. Right? For example, if you have a two-dimensional straight line in two dimensions, you write an equation that gives you y as a function of x. So y equal to mx. In three dimension, you have to specify y and z as a function of x. Okay? That's what you are specifying a straight line. Okay, or any curve. Okay? You specify n minus 1 of the coordinates in terms of the nth coordinate. This, however, is not a very symmetric way of describing it, because this gives special role to one particular coordinate. Right? Because you are choosing one particular coordinate and expressing everything else in terms of that coordinate. A more symmetric way of doing it is to write down n minus 1 equations in n variables. Okay, that's another way of describing a curve. Right? In two dimensions, if you want to describe a curve, you write one equation involving x and y. Right? Some function of x and y equal to 0. Okay, that's the second way of describing the curve. It's symmetric. That it doesn't give any special role to other x or y. Similarly, in three dimensions, you will have to write two equations to describe a curve. Okay, one equation will describe a surface, two equations will describe a curve. This is not breaking the symmetry between different coordinates, but this is somewhat implicit. Okay, you have to actually solve these equations to determine what the curve really is. There is a third way of describing a curve, which is what we'll try to use, okay, and that is the parametric description. So what we do is that we give a curve like this, we choose some arbitrary parameter, let's call it u, to label different points along the curve. And since this is a one-dimensional curve, you need a single variable to specify a point on this curve, right? This u, you can think of as a continuous variable that changes from some value which you can take u to be equal to 0 to some other value which you can take e equal to 1. Okay. That u changes monotonically from 0 to 1 as you move around the curve. But any car, of course, has this property, right? You can level it by some parameter which goes changes from 0 to 1 as you go from the beginning to the end. To specify the car, what you have to do is to specify each coordinate xi as a function of y. These are given functions. So this has the advantage that first of all, it doesn't give any special role to any particular coordinate. Each coordinate is expressed as a function of some parameter u. Second advantage is that it's explicit. Given any u, you can evaluate what the xi's are for that u, right? That specifies a particular point for any given u. You don't have to solve any equation if you are given this function fi. The disadvantage, of course, is that two different sets of functions may actually describe the same curve. And the reason is that this parameter u that you have chosen is arbitrary. Right? You could have, suppose you have fixed this to be 0, this to be 1. Right? Now you could take u equal to 0.5 somewhere in here, or you could choose a u so that 0.5 is somewhere here. Then there is nothing which tells us how to choose this parameter u. Yes, that we want to choose a parameter u which goes from 0 to 1 as you move along the curve. But how you parameterize is completely up to us. We can say that by the time you goes from 0 to half, the curve, you move up to this point in the curve, and then half to 1 describes the rest of the curve. Or you can say that 0 to half describes this part of the curve, and then half to 1 describes the rest. So, formally, okay, we can summarize this by saying that if we make it, if we substitute u to any function, let me call it h of u, okay, which is monotonic. Okay, h of u has the property that it's monotonic function, so it's 1 to 1, and it goes from 0 to 1 as u goes from 0 to 1. Then substituting u by h of u will describe the same curve, even though the functions will be different. Fi of u will become fi of h of u, right? That's a different function altogether. Nevertheless, they'll describe the same curve. So this is an ambiguity that you should keep in mind, okay, but let's live with it, and we want to describe a curve in this parametric form, okay, so which means that given a curve from P to Q, which you want to decide, which you want to see if it describes a geodesic or not, okay, we'll describe it by saying that each xi is given as some function of u, okay, and the only condition on this xi, the condition on the xi, of course, is that it begins at here, okay, so at u equal to 0, this function must correspond to this point, where of course xi values are fixed, and at u equal to 1, the function will correspond to this point. So now we see that we can also describe the nearby part, L plus delta L, so nearby part. Is xi equal to fi of u plus some small number. Let's call it delta fi of u. And delta fi has to vanish at u equal to 0 and 1. Okay. Now we can make this statement more precise. So geodesic will require that delta L is equal to 0 to order delta Fi. Namely, delta L can involve squares of this delta Fi, two factors of delta Fi. But there is no term that is linear in delta alpha. Okay, that will define a geodesic. Okay, that's what we mean by that the curve is extremal. Okay, that the distance that extremize the distance between the two points here. So you basically have to see what the situation implies for us. So to do that, first you have to write down an expression for L. Okay, L is the total length of this curve. Okay, that's what you want to extremize. So this is from P to Q, ds. Okay, ds is the element of length. But this I can write from 0 to 1, du times ds du. Okay, and let me make it a little more specific what you mean by ds du. So integral 0 to 1 du times square root of gij of x dxi du dx du. And this of course has to be evaluated on the plot xi equal to fi of u. Okay, this we should keep in mind. Is this clear? Because you have to basically the path length is square root of gij dxi dx. Okay, that's what you have written here. Okay, except that I have taken a du parameters and then these are dxi du and dxi du. So dxi du is essentially dfi du, right? Because you have to evaluate this on the curve xi equal to fi. So in the following, what you will use is shorthand notation. Okay, we will not write down the fi explicitly, but we will use the shorthand notation. The delta xi will denote delta fi of x. Okay, this is the definition of what you mean by delta xi. Okay, anytime I show delta xi, it's actually delta fi of x. Well, that measures the difference between the xi values in the two curves. So you have to calculate delta L. First order variation, and the variation will come from various sources because this is in fact dfi du, right? Because this has to be evaluated fi. So we are changing this to fi plus delta fi, right? So there will be du of delta fi. That's one source of variation. Similarly from here, and finally gij of course the x dependent object, right? So x itself will change, go to x plus delta x, right? Or x equal to f will become x equal to f plus delta f. So you have to take into account the contribution from all three sources. So you can write this as integral 0 to 1. Okay, this by chain rule of differentiation. I write this as gmn dxn dxn du for minus half times half times. Now we write down the variation of the thing under the square root, okay, as a sum of three terms. The first term will be del k gij of x then delta xk. Okay, again delta xk is nothing but delta x times dxi. Then there will be a term gij of x ddu of delta xi times dxj. And finally, there is a last term, which actually is the same as the second term. Yi of x, dxi, mu, dvu, xj. Okay, all repeated in this for some number. Okay, that's why I have to change it from to mn. Okay, so because there are also I indices here. Is this clear? Okay, now we can combine these two because these are actually the same terms. Gij is asymmetric in I and j. Okay, and these are just related by ij exchange. So I can drop one of these terms and multiply these by two. Just to keep things simple. Now the idea here is the following: that we see that we have delta xi, yeah, ddu of delta xi, here we have delta xk. Our goal will be to write this. So this is what we want to do. The goal is to write this as integral 0 to 1. Du of something times delta xk of u. Okay, this is some expression. If you can write it this way, then we are demanding that delta L is 0 for any delta xk to first order, right? Then next order is delta x square. So then you know that this term has to vanish. Okay, if it has to vanish for any delta x. Okay, and that's the way we want to get the geodesic equation. Okay, this is what we want to do. Now, one issue here, of course, this is index is I. Okay, we have to change it to k, but that's not difficult. We just have to change this index also to k. But the issue that we have to deal with is that this involves ddu of this. Of delta x, right, or delta x to change I to u. But you want to write it in something in this form. So the way we do it is by integrating by parts. This ddu will integrate by parts and the boundary terms. So this will involve two terms. One is ddu acts on the rest of the terms. The other term will involve boundary terms, right? This evaluated at x equal to 0, at u equal to 0 and u equal to 1. But the boundary terms vanish because delta xi is supposed to vanish at the two ends. Right? Because you are only allowed to vary between paths which both start at p and end at q. Okay, so delta x must vanish at the two ends. So the boundary terms will vanish. You can just integrate by parts and put ddu on the other side. On the rest of the terms, the minus side. Is this okay? Okay. Now, of course, it's straightforward. Okay, if you are willing to do some algebra, because ddu of this, okay, will again get lot of terms. Okay, the derivative of this, you'll get this to minus 3, and then ddu of each of these separately, right? You have to evaluate. Okay. But now, we are going to choose the freedom of making u into a function of u. To choose u in a particular way that simplifies analysis. And the way we will choose u is that equal interval in u should describe equal length of the path. Okay, earlier I had said that if you have a path like this, I could choose u so that u equal to 0 here, u equal to 0.5 here, and u equal to 1 here. But now we are going to restrict the choice of u in such a way that you reach u equal to 0.5 only when you have covered half the length of the curve. Okay, you reach 0.25 only when you have covered one quarter of the length of the curve. Okay, that's a specific parameterization of u. Of so now you no longer have a freedom of changing u to some function of u. Okay. So from now on, the equation that will be deriving will be only in that specific u system for that specific choice of u. But suppose you have done that. Okay, suppose you have chosen u so that equal interval in u correspond to equal length apart. What that gains us is the following equation, the dTu of gmn dxm du. This is the path length, right? For suppose you change u by epsilon, the length of the path, okay, when you take an interval of interval epsilon in u, is this times epsilon. Now you want that this shouldn't change as a function of u. Okay, next time you take an interval epsilon, you will get this at the next interval, but that should be. That should not depend on what value of u you have chosen, right? So you divide it into intervals, etc. Okay. If this interval, if this u interval of u from say u1 to u1 plus epsilon corresponds to certain path length, then from u1 plus epsilon to u1 plus 2 epsilon should correspond to the same path length, right? That's how we have chosen u. Okay. So then dTu of this should vanish. Is this clear? And now you see that if we can make this vanish, okay, then our life becomes simple, because then dU of this also is 0. Because after all, there is the inverse of this quantity. Right? So you only have to worry about dU acting on this and this. Is this clear? So this has a name, this is called the affine parameter for describing a path. So let's see what we can get with this. So the same delta L will now become integral 0 to 1. First we write this del k g by j dx I dx j u. Okay, I'll write also delta x k here. Then I have changed this index I to k. Okay, we'll make this into index k. So next term is minus because we are doing integration by parts. dTu g k j x times dxj minus g k j. Came from here. This was GKJ, right? Then, so because when you do integration of the parts, you have to act on this as well as on this, because this is a product, right? So dDU of this times this. Okay. So dDU of this times this, the first one is GKJ. Okay, and dDU are acting on this, give you D2XJ views. Oh, factor of 2 is missing here, right? So factor of 2 here and here. Mm-hmm. So this has to vanish for arbitrary delta x k. Which means that this must vanish. This whole thing must vanish. In order that the original curve is geodesic. Is this okay? See, this is just path length, right? This you are assuming doesn't vanish, finite path length. This is completely arbitrary. This is first order. So the only way this can vanish is if this quantity vanishes. So we'll try to write it in a somewhat neater form. Okay. First you have to get rid of this minus 2 over here by dividing by half. Minus sign also you'll try to get rid of. So let's multiply by minus half g l q times that equation. Okay. And let's start from this end. So minus half minus 2 gives you 1. G L K G K J is delta I J. Delta I J. Okay, so that makes it into D2XL. So D2XL square. Then this one again minus 2 times minus half gives you 1. So plus G L K. Let me write the last term first, dxj du, and then ddu of gkj, so this I can write as del m gkj dxm du. And then minus half, so we can multiply by minus half, g lk LK GIJ DXI DXJ. Okay. So this start with exactly that. What we have the only extra manipulation I have done is here. I have taken the derivative. Okay, by first taking the derivative of respect to x and then dx.
Sir,
on
question of geodesic.
Yes.
We saw that we can represent a geodesic in different means, a line in different ways, and some of them includes that we don't introduce any parameter at all.
That is another way of representing it, yes.
So then the actual equation of geodesic shouldn't contain what here it contains is derivative with respect to y.
Yes, but here the point is we have chosen a specific parameter, u.
So that it looks in a specific
way. Yes, exactly. Right? Because this u is not completely arbitrary. Because this u that we have chosen is in, has been chosen in such a way that you describe equal length and equal interval. Okay? In that system, this is a geodesic.
Means we cannot find any geodesic equation which is independent of parameter, our choice of parameter.
We could, but result it will not look symmetric. Okay? You basically have to eliminate u. You have to solve one of the equations. Okay? Suppose you want to write it in the standard form, right? Curve in the standard form. So what you have to do is that you take one of the equations, say x1 as a function of u, use that to solve for u in terms of x1. Okay? And then rewrite everything in terms of the derivative of the other x's with respect to x1. Yeah, so that can be done, but it will not look symmetric. So this is a much more symmetric form of geodesic.
In some sense, y is equal to x is represented in the same kind of way.
Yeah, if you take y equal to mx plus c, okay, standard equation for the straight line, you can write y equal to au plus b and x equal to Cu plus d, where a, b, c, they are constants. Okay? By eliminating x, you can get y equal to mx plus c. Okay? But it looks much more symmetric. If you use some parameter, you can write it in this form. Okay, so I'll leave it as an exercise to check that this can be rewritten as d2xl u square plus gamma l mn or mij dxl. Okay, basically you have to use the definition of gamma. And so that whatever extra terms involved in my derivatives or metric that you have here, all assemble into gamma li.
This just requires, dividing the second term into two parts using the...
Exactly, yeah. So you write out half, because this is already symmetric in J and M.
So half?
So you half of this plus J and M exchange. Okay, and you can see that it's exactly the gamma L IG that you can introduce. Is this okay? Now I'll also leave it as an exercise to check using this equation that dvu of gmn dxn du dxn du. Okay, we had demanded this to be half equal to 0, but that is saying that this is equal to 0. Okay? Because taking square root, if the quantity is constant, right, its square root is also constant as a function of u. So basically here again this is straightforward. You have to apply ddu on this and on d2xm dt u square and d2xm du square. For these you have to use the geodesic equation and you have to consider this is identical to 0. So in a sense this form of the geodesic equation automatically encodes the fact that u is an affine parameter. Okay? That the path lengths don't vary as you go from one interval to the next interval. Because you don't have to impose any additional condition on it. Okay, it's automatic once you have written in this form. Final exercise. So that in a different coordinate system, the equation becomes basically everything replaced by pi, right? Basically, what you have to do is that you start from here, okay? Assume that xl is some function of x prime. Okay? So dxl du, okay, can be written as in terms of dx prime l du, okay? And then derivative x prime respect to x. Second derivative is similarly. Gamma you can write in terms of gamma prime because we know the transformation of gamma. And similarly, dxl du you can write in terms of dx prime du. And you can show that as a consequence of this equation, this automatically goes. Okay, this is not something that you have to postulate again in a new coordinate system. Now, it's of course not surprising because the physical input that we gave for defining a geodesic, it's the curve of extremal length. The length measure of the curve doesn't depend on what coordinate system you are choosing, right? So, if you have found a curve of extremal length between two points P and Q, in any other coordinate system, it will stay extremal. Right? Any small variation will give you zero first order, irrespective of what coordinate system you choose. Because the definition of geodesic, okay, the intrinsic definition of geodesic includes involves length of the curve. and that is independent of choice of coordinate system. Right? So it better be that this equation retains its form in the prime coordinate system. Okay, but this is something you can explicitly check. Okay, that's if somebody gave you this equation without telling you where it came from, you can still check that this equation takes the same form in the prime coordinate system.
Sir, since gamma is a combination of the first derivative of the matrix, you can make a coordinate system as the second term vanish.
Yes, exactly. We can.
That is a special case.
Exactly. Yeah. So you are going to exploit that.
But that is can be done only at a single point.
Yeah, it can be done only at a single point.
Mm-hmm.
Because you make a coordinate choice to make the first derivative of matrix vanish at some point, specific point, right?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't vanish everywhere, mm-hmm. because then the Riemann tensor itself will vanish. So yes, so that we can do. So around that a given point, we can choose a coordinate system in this zero.
In that that space will look locally flat.
Yeah, it will look locally flat, right? That's the meaning of saying that we have chosen the first derivative of the matrix to zero.
So why would it look locally flat even though gamma is zero?
Yes.
The R, the Ricci curvature, will still be non-zero. The scalar,
yes.
R will still be non-zero, so
yes.
It will still have some curvature.
Yes, yes. So by locally flat, you have to, I mean, clarify what you mean by locally flat, right? It's as flat as you can get to. It looks as flat as you can get to, right? Because you cannot say the Riemann tensor to zero, right? So that, no change of coordinates can do this, right? But this is the closest to flat space that you can get to. That is, in that sense, one can say it's locally flat. Not that you can actually make it flat space. That will make it clear exactly what you mean by this. Now, if we had just Euclidean metric, where gamma, where Gij is just delta ij, okay, or it could be just constant, okay, that doesn't necessarily have to be Gij. So gamma ij is 0. Then of course the equations are very simple, d2xl, and the equation is d2xl du square equal to 0. So you get xl, the general solution for xl is al times u minus alu plus bl, where al, bl are just constants.
This is just simple force equal to 0.
Okay, so far we have not talked about force, right? Eventually we will try to interpret this as the equation of motion of a particle. Right now we are just thinking of this as gamma. Okay, in some Riemannian space with geodesic equation given by this. So this you would recognize is the equation for a straight line. Right? Normally you don't write it in this parametric form, but in this parametric form, this is exactly what we'll call a straight line. And if we eliminate, for example, this one, okay, you could eliminate u, you can write to you could write with x1 minus u1 over a1. And then all the other xls you can write in terms of x1. And you know they are linear functions of x1. And that's what we mean by saying that it's a straight line. So this just shows that the notion of geodesic reduces to the standard notion of a straight line if you are considering flat Euclidean space. But even in flat Euclidean space, if you use a coordinate system in which the matrix doesn't look flat, okay, imagine that you have used polar coordinate system in to describe Euclidean space. Then this is not delta ij, this is not zero. Geodesic equation is more complicated. Right? The solutions are also more complicated. Solutions are not simply linear functions. Nevertheless, those solutions describe straight line. Okay? But in the R theta phi coordinate system. Okay, if you want to write a straight equation for a straight line in the R theta phi coordinate system, it is not simple. Right? You have to, well, it is simple in the sense you can first write in terms of x coordinate, x, y, z, and then transform into the R theta phi. But the equation certainly involve complicated trigonometric functions. Right? That because the relation between x, y, z and r theta phi is complicated. And those are exactly what you will get by solving these equations. Okay, if you solve this in the, if you calculate for example the gamma in the r theta phi coordinate system and solve these equations, okay, you will get complicated solutions. But those will be precisely straight lines written in the polar coordinates. Is this okay?
Sir, in case of Euclidean space, we see that in a particular coordinate system, that is my Cartesian coordinate system, at all points this will hold, this equation will hold.
Yes.
But this is not generally true.
Yes. In curved space, right?
For each point there will be different.
Exactly, different coordinates. What you can do is imagine that. So in curved space, right? Let's say what best you can do. Suppose you are in a curved space. Let's focus on some particular point x0. Okay. We can choose our metric to be constant to be so that the first derivative of the metric finishes at x0. Okay. So we can choose new coordinate system. Coordinate system x prime such that gamma prime I j k equal to 0 at x prime naught. Okay, this we can do, this we know we can do because we have seen it, right? So you can choose our Cijks2 or Dijks2 to make the first derivative of the metric vanish. So let's see how will the equation look like. Okay, in that case, this geodesic equation will look like d2 x prime n v square. It will not be 0, okay, but it will be of order. Suppose we have a curve passing through x0. Okay? And let's imagine that the u0 is the value of u when the geodesic passes through this curve. Okay? So d2x prime and du square, okay, will involve gamma. Gamma is 0 to first order. As you go, so let me write this. This should be of order u minus u naught. There is no constant x. Right? Because at u equal to u naught, you are exactly at x naught. Okay, or x naught prime. In the prime coordinate system, you are at x prime naught. But gamma prime vanishes. So this tells us that this should be order u minus u naught. Is this clear? U equal to u naught, this term should vanish. Right? But this is all you can say. Right? Not that it vanishes identically, the right hand side. So you can integrate this twice. And this will tell us that x prime l in this coordinate system, x prime l has a solution of the form a prime l u plus b prime l plus order u minus u naught u. Why cube? Because this is order u minus u naught, you integrate twice. Okay? So this term will give terms of order u minus u naught q. So the only thing that you can say is that there is no order u minus u naught term. No order u minus u naught square term following integrate. Right? Linear term is there, constant term is there, but no order u minus u naught square. So this is clearly not straight line, but this is as close to straight line as you can get to in a general curved manifold. Okay, there is a linear term, it looks like a straight line here u equal to u naught. at a generic court, a generic coordinate system, that should be put up in an order u minus u naught square term. But in this particular spatial coordinate system, the order u minus u naught square term is absent. The next time is order u minus u naught. So those are some constants. Yeah, those are order one terms. Right. So the point is, if this vanishes at u equal to u naught.
So the next higher term would be a derivative of gamma times the difference u minus u naught.
Exactly.
That is what is coming, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And right. This is what is coming here. Derivative of this gamma, of course, is vanishing at u equal to u naught. Right. So think of the derivative of the whole thing. Okay, you have a card. Okay, as a function of u, it will be derivative of the whole thing times u minus u naught, and then higher order term. But this term at u equal to u naught is zero. Because gamma is zero. It doesn't matter what these are. Okay, so that's what we are using here, order u minus u naught. Because gamma is order u minus u naught, right? Then irrespective of what these are, this is of order u minus u naught. Is this okay? Because if you multiply a constant by u minus u naught, it still is of order u minus u naught, right? These things will only change the coefficients that appear in front of this. So as I said, this is the best you can do. You can go close to a straight line in the sense that there is no quadratic term. But as you go sufficiently far away, okay, you see that you deviate from the straight line. It doesn't look like a straight line anymore. U minus u naught. That's what I mean. Order u minus u naught means is something proportional to u minus u naught. And then the order u minus u naught square and higher order terms also, right? They're not really here. And then you integrate twice. Right? So if you had zero here, you would just get this. Because of the presence of this term, right, you will get q, u minus u naught q, because you are integrating twice. And that's this term. So if there is a constant instead here, then you will also get order u minus u naught square term. The absence of the constant just means that term is not there. Right? It looks like a straight line, and then the next correction is cubic in u minus u naught. Okay, so now I am going to introduce a new concept, tangent vectors and tangent space. But before I say anything, let me just emphasize that even though we'll call tangent vectors, these are not the kind of vectors that we had dealt with earlier. Okay, these are not vectors which are defined, which are some constructs from some functions of the metric. Okay, generally, the answer we said are some functions of the metric which are certain transformations also. Okay. These tangent vectors are not of that kind. Okay, we'll refer to them as vectors, but you should keep in mind that these are completely different kinds of objects. They are called vectors because sometimes the transformation now looks like as if they are transforming as vectors. But we will see that they are not like just regular vectors or tensors that you have introduced earlier. So keep that in mind. Okay, the tangent vectors are not the vector fields or not vectors and tensors in the standard sense. Okay. So there are various ways of introducing tangent vectors, but let me introduce in some terms of the concept that you have already dealing with. That you have been dealing with. So let's suppose you take a point x naught and consider a geodesic passing through x naught. Assume that this is passing through U naught when U is equal to U naught. Okay, U naught is some arbitrary number. Okay, that you have a geodesic. Okay, it doesn't matter where it begins, where it ends, some geodesic which passes through X naught and it happens at U equal to U naught. The question that we'll be interested in is how many parameters do we need to specify the geodesic? Okay, we already are given the fact that the geodesic passes through X naught. How many such geodesics are there passing through X naught? Okay. So this is the analog of asking that given a point in Euclidean space, how many straight lines can you draw? Okay, what are the general parameters that label a straight line? Now we know that in Euclidean space, right, if you have a point, then the straight lines are described by vectors. Right, the directions of the straight line. Consider any straight line passing through that point. Right, they are labeled by vectors. Right. So that notion is what you want to generalize here. Okay, that's what we will call tangent vectors. So let's see how we do that. So we take the geodesic equation d2xn u square plus gamma l. L runs from 1 to n. So this is n second order differential equations. So it needs 2n integration constants. So of these 2n integration constants, n are supplied here because xl at u equal to u naught is given by xl naught. So this gives you n boundary conditions. So we need n more boundary conditions. So those are provided by NL defined NL, which is P XL X equal to X naught. So if you know this as well as the original point X naught, then you have all the information. Then you have 2n integration constants which you can and use to integrate these equations. So this gives n more conditions. So to specify the geodesic completely, we have to specify NL. Yeah, this is an n dimensional vector. Is this clear? Because n runs from 1 to n, right? An n dimensional vector. This is known as a tangent vector to the geodesic. Okay, given a geodesic, this is a tangent vector. So this object n1 to nn is the tangent vector perpendicular to the geodesic at x naught. Yes, exactly. That's the set of things. If you think of this as n component vector, then this is the tangent vector.
So if we give the point and this vector, then completely know the geodesic.
Geodesic, exactly. Because then you have supplied the two initial conditions that you need to solve this. Is this clear? Yes. So the point is that this is a second order differential equation, so 2n second order, n second order differential equation, so you need 2n boundary conditions, of which n are already supplied because you have said that geodesic passes straight, right? So at u equal to u naught, it goes straight. Now if we define NL to be this, and if we specify what is NL sub, right, that gives you n more boundary conditions, right? And that determines the curve, this the solution completely. So to determine the geodesic, okay, that means to determine the solution, a particular solution to this equation, you need to specify the vector NL. So this vector NL is known as a tangent vector to the geodesic. So in order to specify a geodesic passing through a point, okay, it is enough if we just specify the tangent vector. Okay, because then from there on, you can use the geodesic equation to solve for the curve completely. It's like straight line. If you want to describe a straight line passing through a point, okay, you just have to tell where the tangents to the straight line, what vector describes the tangent to the straight line. Okay. Then the equation of a straight line determines the straight line completely. Is this clear? For a general curve, of course, that specifying the tangent doesn't specify the curve, right? Because you have to also see how the curve is curving, right? Somewhere else. But for a straight line, we know that tangent vector, specifying the tangent vector, describes the straight line completely everywhere. Okay. And that also is true for the geodesic. Is this okay? In fact, just as in the case of straight line, we don't really need the full vector. Okay. We only need its direction. Yes. Right? Because to specify a straight line, right, we have to only specify the direction of the straight line, right? Mm-hmm. Not the magnitude. Magnitude of the tangent is not relevant. Mm-hmm. The same is true here, because after all, u can be reparameterized, right? I have said that u has to be chosen so that equal length of u gives equal interval. Mm-hmm. But if you scale u by overall constant, that fact still remains the same. Mm-hmm. Right? Scaling u by overall constant doesn't alter the fact that equal length of u corresponds to equal interval. Mm-hmm. So by scaling u, you can change the overall magnitude of NL, right? It just multiplies NL by an overall constant. So multiplying NL by an overall constant doesn't actually change the tangent vector. Okay. Nevertheless, we will keep the overall constant, that information also in. It just tells us that this corresponds to a particular parameterization of u. Right? So specifying the NL completely not only specifies the tangent vector, but also specifies the parameterization that you are using, right? What kind of scaling of u you are using. Is this clear? So tangent space at x naught is a vector space containing all such vectors n. Because it's a capital N dimensional vector space, and given any element of the tangent space, that means given any vector in the tangent space, it describes a geodesic. So the tangent space at a given point, you can think of this as the space that describes the collection of geodesics that can pass through that point. Given any element of the specifying an element of the tangent space means you are specifying a particular vector in this N dimensional vector space. And once you have specified the particular vector, you have specified a geodesic. Is this clear? Yes. So the notion of a tangent space, okay, is simply that it's a collection of vectors. See, this is a tangent vector to a specific geodesic. Then given a geodesic, we describe what is a tangent vector. tangent space at x naught is the collection of all possible such vectors, right? Which means that it's a collection of all possible initial conditions that you can set on the geodesic. Okay, in which direction you start moving. So, in Euclidean space, right, the notion of tangent space in a Euclidean space will be that you take any given point, and the tangent space at that point is a collection of all straight lines that passes through that point. Okay. So, here instead of having the collection of all straight lines that pass through this point, the tangent space gives a collection of all possible geodesics that can pass through that point. Yeah, that's the meaning of tangent space. Okay, it's a vector space, it's an n-dimensional vector space, and given any element of that vector space, it has the interpretation of this specific geodesic through x naught. Yes.
Yeah, although this may hold true in any Euclidean space, is that necessarily true on a curved space or a manifold? Because
well,
if you take any curve,
yes,
right, and you look at the tangent at the starting point,
yes,
you take collection of all of these,
yes,
these will also include the ones, these will also include the geodesics in there. So essentially the tangent space at that point is a larger vector space than the one described.
Yes. Well, once you start in, worrying about the global issues.
Right.
Okay. Locally, yeah, the tangent space will be the collection of all possible geodesics. Okay. But of course, as you said, that some geodesics may actually be the same.
Right.
Yeah. Some things which may look like different geodesics may actually be part of the same geodesic. And yes, so there are global issues of that kind. But locally, this is true. Right. If you don't worry about what is happening to them far away,
mm-hmm,
yeah, so the geodesics actually eventually join,
right,
and this is what will say is the collection of geodesics. Yeah, so what is, well, it's even in the Euclidean space, right? Imagine that you have a point here. Okay. You consider geodesics going out of this, right? But of course you know that a geodesic going this way will eventually return here. The great circles are the geodesics on a sphere, right? So this geodesic is not different, is different from this geodesic. It's not, is the same. Yeah, because this geodesic actually returns. Okay. So, there are global issues that two tangent vectors may actually describe the same geodesic. Yeah, because they may go up, away and then eventually far away, because the space is carved, they may actually become part of the same geodesic. Okay. So, this is not taking into account those. So, when I said the tangent space is the collection of geodesics to a point, right, it's only locally. If you don't look at how they are connected far away, okay, then tangent space is describes the collection of geodesics around the point. When the metric is Lorentzian, then there are more possible connections of this kind. Now, in what sense are the vectors? Okay, they are vectors because, as we will see, that they are transformed like vectors. Okay, but again, keep in mind that these are not the vector tensor fields that we have introduced.
The vector tensors we have introduced is residing, up till now, they are residing on the manifold itself, right?
Yeah, and their properties of the manifold, right? They
yes,
are constructed out of the matrix.
But when we are talking about this tangent space, this is a different space constructed out of one point.
Yeah,
of the
and this is, I mean, a tangent vector, for example, depends on the geodesic that you are taking, right?
Yes.
Given the metric, the tangent vector at a point is not fixed. There are
yes,
many geodesics
yes,
passing through that point.
So it depends on the parameterization.
Yeah, it depends on the parameter. So the dependence on the parameterization, we will see what it is.
And in the case, as we are defining two vector spaces differently, like those vector spaces reside on the manifold and these vector spaces are not residing on the same manifold. That's why we cannot compare this.
Yeah, you know, those are not the vector spaces, right? I'm not called vectors
yes,
and tensors,
yes,
right? Those
but
are not
have,
necessarily vector
yes,
spaces in,
yes, yes,
in any sense, right? So don't, I mean, keep them as distinct, right? Those are just constructed out of metric, right? Those are properties of the manifold. As so far, what you have done, we have not talked about any tensors or vectors which are not constructed out of the metric. These are not functions of the metric. This of course depend on the metric because geodesic depends on the metric, okay, but this also depends on the geodesic that you choose.
Mm-hmm.
Nevertheless, consider the following problem. Let's suppose that we have a point x naught and a car passing through x naught. So for a geodesic, pass it through X naught. So corresponding to this geodesic, there is some NL. Which I think it is DXL DU evaluated X naught. Now we take the same geodesic, but look at it in a different coordinate system. Okay? And ask what is the tangent vector that describes that geodesic at the same point. So n prime l will be dx prime l du at x prime naught. And x naught and x prime naught at the same point, that's written in different coordinate system. But this, of course, I can write. Okay, once I know this in one coordinate system, I can always convert it back to the original coordinate system. So this I can write as del m x prime l and dxm du at x naught. At x equal to x naught. Right? Which is the same as x prime equal to x prime. This was x prime equal to x prime naught. So this is del m x prime l evaluated at x naught at x equal to x naught times n m. Because dxm du at x equal to x naught was the original tangent vector in the old coordinate system. So this tells you how to relate the tangent vectors in different coordinate frames.
So is the transforming like a z
tensor? Yeah, so this is the reason why you call the vectors in the first place. Right? Even though they are not vector fields. Yeah. Yeah, they refer to a specific geodesic. Putting a different geodesic, this will be different. Okay, yeah. NM will be different. This factor will be the same. Yeah, but NM will be different, and as a result, n prime will also be different. So these tangent vectors are properties not only of the metric but also of particular geodesic that we take to a given point. Is this okay? Consider the following problem. Suppose we are given a manifold and let's take two points x1 and x2 in some coordinate system. We have some geodesic passing through x1 and let's take some other geodesic passing through x2. Corresponding to this geodesic, we can describe a tangent vector which we will call NL. At x1. Corresponding to this geodesic, we can describe a tangent vector which we will call ML. L initial transform. One particular tangent vector at this and one particular tangent vector at this. Now we want to ask that is there any sense that you can test whether these vectors are parallel or not? Well, A and M as two vectors, are they parallel?
Okay.
We'll try that and we'll see what the problem is. Right? Now, suppose you are working in flat space. Then this question has an answer. Right? Imagine two cars. Okay, one passing through P, one car passing through Q. Now, you know in flat space what exactly one means by tangent. Right? Draw a car to the first, take the car that passes through P, draw a tangent. Okay, that gives some straight line. Take the car passing through Q, draw a tangent. Okay, that gives a straight line. And it makes sense to ask if these two straight lines are parallel or not. Right? So two straight lines passing through two different points which never intersect, we can nevertheless determine whether they are parallel or not. Here, we can try the same game. Okay, so let's try it. We say that n, suppose let's try that n is parallel to m if nl is equal to lambda times nl for some lambda. Now choose a different coordinate system. So n prime l is will be given by del m del k at x1 or x prime 1 times nl nt. And m prime l will be given by del k x prime l x prime 2 times nt. Now we have chosen nk to be proportional to mk. But these quantities are different. These are matrices are different. Okay? This matrix and this matrix doesn't have to be the same matrix. In fact, they are different because this is a derivative with respect with x prime 1, this is a derivative at x prime 2. So even if you start by taking them to be parallel, in this new coordinate system, they will not look parallel.
This lambda will change.
No, the constant will if only the constant change, you will have been happy. But if you take two vectors which are parallel to begin with and multiply by two different matrices, yeah, the vectors are not even proportional to each other.
Sir, is there always possible like in some coordinate system
linear transformation?
Yeah, if you yes, if it's linear transformation, then of course it will not make a difference. Okay. Because linear transformation means that this matrix and this matrix will be the same. Okay. But general coordinate transformation will have this problem. Now this problem is there also in flat space. Okay. Suppose you start with the flat space and going to spherical polar coordinates. Okay. Two vectors which are parallel in flat space, two straight lines which are parallel in flat space, in spherical polar coordinate system will not look parallel. Right? Because this and this can be referred in. So you go from flat space flat Euclidean coordinate to spherical coordinate. Right? Because r, theta, phi are complicated functions of x, y, z. Right? These derivative matrices are different in general. Nevertheless, in flat space we think that there is a notion of parallelism, two straight lines in parallel. And the reason that total notion exists is because there is some kind of preferred coordinate system that we have in our mind, which is in which the metric is constant. Okay, that's a preferred coordinate system in each which you use to determine if two lines are parallel or not. The same description will not work for arbitrary coordinate system, even in flat space. The problem in curved space is that we don't have such preferred coordinate system. In general, there is no coordinate system in which the metric is constant. Okay? And that's the reason why there is no unambiguous way of determining whether these two vectors are parallel. Is this clear? Yeah. Take just normal three-dimensional Euclidean space. take two straight lines which are parallel to each other. So the two tangent vectors, take two arbitrary points on these two straight lines and look at the tangent vectors in the spherical polar coordinate system. They will not look parallel to each other, right? They will not be proportional to each other. So if in spherical polar coordinate system, somebody gave you two vectors, two tangent vectors, it will be very hard to determine if they are parallel or not. Right? The only way to, the simplest way to determine is to go back to the original coordinates, the Cartesian coordinate system. Okay. So the notion of what is parallel in flat space is inherited from the Cartesian coordinate system. Okay, that's a preferred coordinate system. That's some spatial coordinate system in which you define what you mean by parallel straight lines. And this preferred coordinate system has a property that the metric is constant. In a general chord space, there is no such coordinate system. That, and that is the reason why you cannot determine unambiguously, at least as of now, okay, as from whatever we have told you, whether two vectors are parallel or not.
Two straight lines.
Yes.
They are parallel.
Yes.
In the Cartesian system.
Yes.
Now, if I rewrite the equations in the polar coordinate.
Yes.
They will continue to be parallel, but component-wise they will not be proportional.
Okay. And the reason that they will continue to be parallel because that's how you define what you mean by two parallel straight lines. Okay. So now the question is there any way that you can rescue this situation? Okay. That in chord space it looks like that if you take two different points, there is no simple way to unambiguous way of determining whether two geodesics are parallel or not. So what we'll do, okay, is to use the intuition from flat space, okay, which is that we define the notion of two geodesics in parallel, okay, by going to a preferred coordinate system in which the metric is flat. Now, what we can do in chord space in general is that we cannot take the metric flat. But we can choose a coordinate system in which the metric looks flat to first order. Namely, the first derivative of the metric vanishes. We know that there is such a coordinate system. Okay, first derivative of the metric can be made to vanish at a given point. Okay? So, using that, we can now look at this problem in a slightly different way. Okay, we change our question. Okay, and then we can try to answer it.
So, but then we are doing coordinate transformations at
yes.
each of the points separately. So, how do we know that the coordinate transformation at x1 is this? It will be entirely different from the coordinate transformation at x2, which will be required to make it flat to first degree.
Yes, so it's true what you are saying, and we will see how to address that. Right?
Okay.
We'll not. That's why I said we'll not be able to answer this most general question. We have to change our question, and then we'll be able to answer it. And so what we do now is that we don't try to decide whether two tangent vectors at far away points are parallel. But let's imagine that we take two close by points. Okay, we'll try to make it more specific as we go along. But qualitatively, let's imagine that we take two close by points. Then, if you have made the derivative of the metric 0 here, the derivative of the metric is not 0 here, but it's small, right? Using that, we can try to define a notion of what we mean by two tangent vectors being parallel if the points are close. Namely, if we take two points which are close to each other, then we can decide on whether two tangent vectors are parallel by going to the specific coordinate system in which the first derivative of the metric vanishes. Okay, so that the metric looks more or less flat very close to that point. Then second derivative doesn't vanish, of course. And then we can ask if in that coordinate system the two tangent vectors are parallel. Okay, in this sense. That is the closest to flat coordinate, the Cartesian coordinate in flat space that you can get. Is this point clear? The point is, if we really had a flat metric, right, then the way to decide two lines are parallel is to go to the Cartesian coordinate system and see if the two vectors are proportional. This we cannot do in a general flat, card space. But in general card space, we know that it is possible to choose the matrix, the coordinates in such a way that around any given point x naught, we will take the first derivative of the metric vanish. Now, if you take a nearby point, x naught plus delta x naught, here of course the first derivative of the metric is not zero. Okay? But it is small in some sense, that will make clear later, right? It's small. The first derivative of the metric will be of all delta x naught. Because it will be the second derivative times delta x naught after all, right? Because first derivative, change in the first derivative is the second derivative times the difference. So it will be small in the sense that this, if the first derivative is 0 here, the first derivative here will be proportional to delta x naught. Okay, for small enough delta x naught, it is small. So let's take that coordinate system. And now let's try to compare two geodesics. One passing through x naught, one passing through x naught plus delta x naught. We'll say that the two tangent vectors, NL and ML, are parallel only if they satisfy conditions like this in that particular coordinate system. Is this clear? So choose. So choose x prime coordinates such that gamma prime ijk is 0 at x prime equal to x prime naught, and then say if n is a tangent vector x naught and m is a tangent vector at x naught and delta x naught, then m and m are parallel if n prime l equal to lambda n prime l. But of course, we don't expect that this should be true in general. There are corrections. Then we will see what these corrections are. Okay, the idea is the correction should vanish sufficiently fast as the two points become closer and closer. We'll in fact introduce a slightly restricted notation, okay, that of parallel transport, where two vectors are not only parallel but they are also equal in magnitude. So parallel transport this will mean that so M is called the parallel transport of n. If n prime is equal to n prime. So m is parallel transport of n. This statement is an arbitrary coordinate system. But to test whether this is true, you have to go to the prime coordinate system where this gamma prime is 0 at x prime naught, and m prime should be n prime plus order delta x naught square. Okay, and we'll see why this particular power. So what this allows us to do is to define the notion of parallelly transporting a tangent vector from one point to a close by point. Okay, not to an arbitrarily far point. Now, why this part?
I'll just discuss that and then stop.
This part you can figure out by the following reasoning. You see, we want to find the x prime coordinate system in which gamma prime I j k is 0 at x prime equal to x prime naught. Okay? But this coordinate system is not unique. Why not? Because remember that we went from x to x prime. By adjusting that C's, we had the A's and the B's and the C's and so on, right? A's we said doesn't matter, okay? A we can take to be some constant once and for all, so let's set A fixed. We then adjusted the B's to make the gamma set, the first derivative of the matrix 0. Okay? So as long as we have adjusted the B's appropriately, we have already made gamma prime 0. But you still have the freedom of adjusting the C's. Right? C's are completely arbitrary, right? Suppose you have fixed the B's, okay, to make gamma prime 0 at x prime. The C's involve, why aren't the C's relevant, right? The C's are not relevant because when you use the effect, see the effect of C on how gamma transforms, that is involves x prime minus x prime naught, factors of x prime minus x prime naught. So those vanish in any case at x prime equal to x prime naught. That's why, irrespective of how you choose the C's, the result is not affected. Gamma prime is still 0. So when we say that we define the notion of being two vectors being parallel by going to this coordinate system, this still leaves a freedom of choosing that coordinate system. Right? Gamma prime has been made to be 0, but the coordinate system has not been fixed completely. So whatever condition you specify, better be invariant under that kind of change of coordinates, which leave gamma prime 0. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. Right? Suppose you say that n prime l is exactly equal to lambda n prime l. Now, there may be two different coordinate systems, in both of which gamma prime is 0 at x naught. Nevertheless, in one, n prime l is exactly equal to lambda n prime l, and n prime l is exactly equal to n prime. But in the other coordinate system, n prime and n prime are different. Mm-hmm. That could happen. Then this condition that m prime is exactly equal to n prime will not make sense. Is this clear? It will be ill-defined because we are saying that we take a coordinate system x prime in which gamma prime is 0. And in that coordinate system, we define parallel transform by saying that m prime and n prime are equal. But because the coordinate system itself is not determined completely, we cannot demand that, if you take two different such coordinate systems in which this is 0, right? In one of them, m prime may be equal to n prime. In other one, m prime and n prime may differ by some number. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you have to see how much they differ by. Mm-hmm. And it's easy to figure out that difference is of order delta x or square. Mm-hmm. Why? Because the relation between m prime and n prime, right? When you change coordinate system, it involves the first derivative, del x prime, del x naught. Mm-hmm. So the C's, which are cubic, right? When you take del x prime, del x naught, that del x prime del x, that gets rid of one part of x minus x naught. Okay, you are still left with two powers. And because of this you can demand only up to this. Okay? Okay, this order delta x naught square terms will change, can be made to change simply by choosing different coordinate systems, each of which satisfies this condition. Is this point clear? So let me repeat again. The point is that this, we are trying to define the notion of parallel transport by going to a specific coordinate system, which you have said is this. But this condition does not fix the coordinate system completely. Okay, there is an ambiguity. And whatever condition you demand of M and N being parallel transports of each other, better be not affected by this ambiguity. Right? Otherwise, this condition doesn't make sense. In one coordinate system, the parallel transport rule may hold. In another coordinate system, it may not hold. So what you demand is something that doesn't change, that doesn't get affected by this ambiguity. And it's this condition that is not affected by this ambiguity. If m prime and n prime differ by order delta x naught square in one coordinate system, then you can show that in another coordinate system in which gamma prime still is 0 at x naught, x prime naught, these two will continue to differ by order delta x naught square. Yes. On the other hand, if you go to the x coordinate system where gamma was not 0, then in that coordinate system, okay, you go from x prime to x by exploiting the c's, sorry, the b's, right? B is multiply x minus x naught square, or x prime minus x prime naught square, right? So when you take the first derivative, it's linear in x prime minus x prime naught. So effect of those will give an order delta x naught contribution. So by demanding that the order delta x naught contribution is 0, okay, you are safe, okay, that you have used as much as you could, okay, on the special property of this, but you have not used more than what you should have. So we had some questions.
So this order of delta x naught square, so how much big this can be allowed?
This basically means that the m prime and n prime, the difference, will be some quadratic term in delta x.
I mean, the quadratic term will have coefficient very small. Is that
okay? No, the coefficient may be big, but it's small because delta x naught is small. Right? That's why you are defining the notion of parallel transformation to neighboring points. Okay, that the two neighboring points whose different distance is some delta x naught. You can define what you mean by parallel, m and n being parallel. Up to terms of order delta x naught square. Okay, but we will see that it is not, I mean, this is good enough for describing what you mean by parallel transport. Okay, we don't have to care about order delta x naught square terms. Is this okay? Differential equation of what you mean by parallel transport. Okay, so basically what you will do is you will take say the following. Okay. Now imagine that you have some chord, okay, not a geodesic, arbitrary chord. Okay. And take a point here, x naught, okay, and take some vector, n, tangent vector at x naught. Then, with the help of this, what you can do is to define a parallel transport of this tangent vector at a neighboring point, sufficiently close. Then, using that, you can define the parallel transport of that vector to a neighboring point, and so on. So, this way, in principle, you can start from a given point x naught and keep parallel transporting, okay, small at a time, by small amount at a time, okay, using this equation. And see what this vector becomes in somewhere else. Okay, that's the notion of parallel transporting this vector along a curve. And this will derive a differential equation starting from here. Okay, using the m prime equal to n prime relation, we will see that we can write a differential equation that doesn't require choice of a coordinate system. Okay, we'll be able to write a differential equation independently of the choice of coordinate system. And the solution to the differential equation, or to the differential equation, will tell us how to parallel transport, starting from some vector n in the tangent space to another vector in the tangent space elsewhere. Is this okay? Nevertheless, as we will see, that this will still not be able not decide, not let us decide if who are we given two tangent vectors, one here and one here, whether they are parallel. And the reason is that you can go from here to here by along many paths. Right? You can go along this path or you can go along this path. Right? Take the same tangent vector and start parallel transporting. And what you will see is that what you get, the vector that you get here will depend on what path you choose. So, we will not be able to use this to determine if two different tangent vectors at two different points are actually parallel to each other. Okay, that will depend on what path you measure. Okay. But this is the best you can do. So, okay, what we will see explicitly all this next time.
That's